Hebrews 12, 14 through 24. Pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. Looking carefully, lest anyone fall short of the grace of God. Lest any root of bitterness springing up cause trouble, and by this many become defiled. Lest there be any fornicator or profane person like Esau, who for one morsel of food sold his birthright. For you know that afterward, when he wanted to inherit the blessing, he was rejected. For he found no place for repentance, though he sought it diligently with tears. For you have not come to the mountain that may be touched, and that burned with fire into blackness and darkness and tempest, and the sound of a trumpet and the voice of words, so that those who heard it begged that the word should not be spoken to them anymore. For they could not endure what was commanded. And if so much as a beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned or shot with an arrow. And so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, "I am exceedingly afraid and trembling." But you have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly, to the church of the firstborn who are registered in heaven, to God, the judge of all, to the spirits of just men made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaks better things than that of Abel. He who has ears to hear the word of God, let them hear it. Let's pray. Father, as we contemplate now what your holiness means for our worship, we pray that that Holy Ghost who has raised us from the dead in Christ and who is making a home for himself within us, and who even now is preparing us for glory, that he might help us understand these heavenly things by a divine and supernatural light. For we ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen. I was at the Christian Booksellers Convention this summer in July, signing a book, when one of the people from Banner of Truth came over to me and handed and said, "R.C., when you're finished here, would you please come over to our booth, because we have a book coming out that I know you're going to like." And so I went over, and he handed me a copy, a pre-release copy of Ian Murray's book, Evangelicals Divided. And I took it home, and I read it, and I have to say I read a lot of books. But when I read this book, it was an epiphany for me. So as soon as I finished it, I ordered 20 copies and sent a copy to each member of the board of directors of Ligonier Ministries, to each member of the session of St. Andrew's Church where I serve, and to each member of the executive team of Ligonier Ministries, and I said to them, please read this book. Because what Ian Murray did was that he gave an exposition of 19th century liberalism with particular focus on the influence of Friedrich Schleiermacher, and then drew a line not from Schleiermacher to 20th century liberalism, which is the line that is usually drawn, but rather drew a line from Schleiermacher's theology to 20th century British and American evangelicalism. Now, not everybody is familiar with Schleiermacher, and there are few indeed who can spell his name. My best friend in seminary grew up in the jungles of the Sudan, and he learned the English language phonetically, and he had trouble with his exams and term papers in seminary when he would spell shoe, S-H-U. You can imagine what he did to Schleiermacher. And he had turned in a term paper on Schleiermacher, which the professor commented. He said one student wrote about Schleiermacher, and I think that what he did when he spelled his name on the typewriter was he wrote S-C-H and then sneezed. Well, 19th century liberal theology in general grew out of the Enlightenment, and the crisis of the Enlightenment, the primary premise of the Enlightenment, was that the God hypothesis is no longer necessary for us to account for the universe in which we live or for the origin of human life. And the driving agenda of many of the Enlightenment philosophers, particularly the French encyclopedias, including Diderot, who identified himself, quote, as the personal enemy of God, was to free Western civilization from unwarranted intrusions from supernaturalism. And that baton was handed to the theologians of the 19th century who tried to reconstruct Christianity along purely naturalistic lines, so that anything in the scripture that bespoke of the supernatural was expunged. The virgin birth had to go, the miracles of Jesus had to go, predictive prophecy in the Old Testament had to go. The atonement as a cosmic event was rejected, and certainly the resurrection could not be believed by modern man and is replaced by swooned theories and resuscitation theories of an almost dead Jesus. And certainly there was the rejection of the ascension and the parousia of Christ. Well, at the beginning of the 20th century, some of those who grew up within the influence of the philosophy and theology of Schleiermacher, the philosophy of Hegel, and the influence of liberal theology, reacted against their own mentors. And I think of three people, particularly within Christendom, and four thinkers of the first half of the 20th century, who reacted negatively against the influence of Schleiermacher. Schleiermacher, by the way, reduced religion to what he called an Abhängigkeitsgefühl. And we all know what that means. Some kind of fool anyway, huh? It is what he described as a visceral sense, a feeling of dependence. So what it means to be religious is to have this sense of dependence upon God, but who the God to which we are feeling dependent is by no means the biblical God. Because what 19th century liberalism did was they reduced God to part of the process of this world. And what was lost primarily in 19th century liberal theology was the transcendence of God, the supernatural. That is, God's being above and beyond the limits of this universe. Now, the people who reacted included a German anthropologist and theologian who wrote a very small monograph under the simple title Das Heilige, which was translated into English by the title The Idea of the Holy. And it was Rudolf Otto who, exploring people's response in culture to whatever it is they deemed to be holy, that he said that what people sensed was a certain numinous, a certain plus, something going beyond ordinary human experience that he defined in terms of the phrase mysterium tremendum. That is, any time a person experiences the uncanny sense of the holy, that experience is always shrouded in mystery, and it provokes a kind of inner dread or fear, a trembling in the soul. And Otto, in trying to explain that sense of the holy, introduced an expression which I think had tragic consequences, by the way. He spoke in German of what he called the ganz anderen, which being translated means the complete or totally other. What he was trying to do was not redefine God as the later thinkers did in terms of their phrase holy other, W-H-O-L-L-Y, that God is so transcendent that there's no point of contact between him and us. But what Otto was trying to say was, when we encounter the God of Christianity, we are dealing with a God who can never be identified with this world and with history or even with our humanity. But he is different from us. He is transcendent in his majesty. And so what was driving Rudolf Otto, among other things, was to recover the sense of the holy, of God's transcendent, supernatural otherness, his majesty that defines him. Now, right on his heels came the new school of theologians called the dialectical theologians, or the neo-orthodox school of theology, which you cannot understand Karl Barth, Emil Brunner, Paul Althaus, and even Rudolf Bultmann without understanding their background and their protest against the bankruptcy of 19th century liberalism. Karl Barth, for example, when he would lecture at Basel, every year he gave a course on the theology of Schleiermacher. And what he did was he had this bust of Friedrich Schleiermacher on his desk. And he would come in and he would lecture about the theology of Schleiermacher. And he would carry on a dialogue, as it were, with this bust, although it was one way, if there could be a one-way dialogue. He would pose questions to Schleiermacher. What do you think about that, Friedrich? And he would talk to Schleiermacher. He would criticize Schleiermacher. And then he would supply Schleiermacher's answer to his own questions. And at the end of the course, after Barth had given his comprehensive critique of Schleiermacher, he walked over to his desk, took his hand, knocked the statue onto the floor where the bust of Schleiermacher was smashed into 1,000 pieces. And Barth says, and so much former Mr. Schleiermacher. And that was the end of that. But again, Bart was trying to recover the supernatural, the sense of the holy. Now, I believe he went way too far. In fact, I think he went so far that neo-orthodoxy would be better spelt without the E in neo. But then we get to his compatriot, Emil Brunner, who also wrote several volumes of importance, one on the person and work of Christ under the title Das Mittler, or The Mediator. And in that book, Brunner, speaking about 19th century liberal theology, said that he could reduce liberal theology to one word. And the word that he chose was unbelief. He said, at bottom, what 19th century liberalism is a monument to unbelief. And then later, we heard from a Jewish philosopher in the middle of the 20th century who wrote a book with a fascinating title, The Eclipse of God. The Eclipse of God. And I thought, what a marvelous metaphor to describe what is happening not only in the mainline churches, but also in evangelical churches in the world today. There is an eclipse of the nature and the character of God. Now, what happens in an eclipse, ladies and gentlemen? You've heard of solar eclipses where the shadow blots out the radiance of the sun so that you can't see the sun. And the light of the sun is so concealed that in its place comes an oppressive darkness. In fact, when complete solar eclipses have happened in past ages, people who were not aware of the scientific explanation of eclipses often panicked beyond belief, thinking that the sun would stop shining forever. But an eclipse does no damage to the sun. An eclipse effects no change in the nature of the sun. The whole time during a solar eclipse, the sun is still there, and it's still shining in the fullness of its magnitude. But it's being concealed by a shadow of the world. What a metaphor Martin Buber used to describe the theological condition of the 20th century. Now, a couple of weeks ago, I had a friend visit me who's the pastor of a large church in America, and he came with a list of theological questions that he wanted to ask. And the first thing he asked me was about miracles. And he said, R.C., he said, what's the difference between the miraculous and the supernatural? Let me ask it again. What's the difference between the miraculous and the supernatural? I said, that's easy. It's the difference between genus and species. All miracles, true miracles, are supernatural events. But not all supernatural events are miracles. And I quickly found out why he asked the first question, because he went to the second question and he was asking what he was really concerned about was the doctrine of regeneration, of rebirth. And he said to me, R.C., I've been in the ministry for 30 years, he said, and I really want to understand regeneration. Can you help me? And I was immediately stricken with a sense of ambivalence. On the one hand, I was delighted that he asked me that, because I wanted to pounce on him and say, I think that's the biggest problem we have in the church today, is that people don't have a clue what regeneration is. And the other side of me wanted to say to my friend, you're a teacher of Israel and you don't know what regeneration is? Where have you been, Nicodemus? When I began to explain for him the doctrine of regeneration and what it involves, I talked to him about the work of God, the work of the Holy Spirit, who supernaturally and immediately, and I don't mean immediately with respect to time, though it is that too, but that is without any means, without any stuff that he uses, but who directly, sovereignly, supernaturally, and divinely changes the constituent nature of a human being from above, creating faith in an unbelieving heart, changing the disposition of the will from one who was disinclined towards the things of God, changing that inclination so that now that person who was dead in sin and trespasses is brought alive to the things of God, and that which he hated and from which he fled day in and day out, now he loves, he seeks, he embraces. Luther called it a miracle. I don't call it a miracle. I think Luther was playing loose with the word miracle when he said that, because a miracle is reserved for something much more narrow than that, something that happens in the external perceivable world. And regeneration doesn't happen where you can see it. It happens in the soul. But the point is, it is a supernatural work of God that no person can accomplish in his own flesh. You can't walk down an aisle and make a decision to be born again. Only God, the Holy Spirit, can raise you from the dead. Now, where did he go from there? He said, well, that means that the only way we can have revival in my church is if God does it. I said, right. I said, I'm almost amused when I see signs on church billboards that say, revival next week. And they give you the dates. You can't schedule a revival because no one can manipulate the sovereignty of God. I said, what I can do if I want a revival is I can pray my heart out and I can preach my lungs out, and my job is to be as accurate as I possibly can be in setting forth the Word of God. But the ministry of that Word has its power not from me, not from scholarship, not from human eloquence, but by God the Holy Spirit. And I said, when I was a kid, one of my best friends was a real tough guy. His name was Buster, appropriately. Buster got a summer job in our community as a hod carrier. How many of you don't know what a hod carrier is? Raise your hand, look around, you're going to find out. At construction sites in the north, during the building of a brick building, the artist was the bricklayer or the mason. And he would be there by the wall with his trial, doing his artistry. But he had helpers. There's one guy there mixing mud in this great big thing where he's mixing up the cement and providing cement for the artist, who didn't have to go lugging cement all over the construction site. But then there was always some strong guy, like Buster, who had this big wooden box. It was on the end of a pole. And he'd be over there by the huge big pile of bricks, and his job was to take 50 bricks or so and pack them into this box-like thing, put them over his shoulder, and then lug them over to the wall and place them at the feet of the bricklayer. I said, that's what the preacher is. He's a hod carrier. We carry the bricks, but only the Spirit can build the wall. And the next thing he said, what does that mean for worship? I think one of the biggest crises we have in the church today, folks, is worship. Because what happens in our Sunday morning services nowadays is everything but worship. We're now even designing worship, not for the believer, but for the unbeliever. Now, I'm all for evangelism, but not on the appointed hour for the assembling together of the people of God. Because worship is designed for regenerate people. It is the regenerate who are called together, those whom the Spirit has changed, and he brings them together that they may offer the sacrifice of praise to their God, to honor him and to give glory to him. My former pastor before I answered the call to be in the pulpit, and boy am I glad for that call. The funnest thing I do right now is in our church. But our former pastor, Mike Malone, used to always say, and I'm sure he still always says, because he loves worship and he loves to lead worship. And what Mike would always say about worship is, what we're about here is a taste of heaven. I love that metaphor. And see, heaven is above nature. Heaven is the abode of the transcendent majesty of God. And if we're tasting heaven when we come together to worship in our churches, that means, ladies and gentlemen, that worship in the Christian sense is to be a supernatural event. Let me say it again. Worship is to be a supernatural event. And when we drag it down from heaven and make it simply an occasion for the celebration of our humanity, focusing attention on pop psychology, on our felt needs, and on human relationships, all of which are important, then that's where we dwell, at the level of nature. And we have surrendered to Schleiermacher and his cronies from the 19th century. Because we have bought into a Christianity without transcendence, a Christianity without the supernatural. When I was a sophomore in college, I was invited by the head of the philosophy department where I went to school to go to a special conference that was being held at Westminster Seminary in Philadelphia on the philosophy of Hermann Duyverd. And so my professor drove me across the Pennsylvania Turnpike, and we arrived in Philadelphia and went to Westminster Seminary, and I attended these lectures. by Cornelius Van Til, John Murray, Ned Stonehouse, E.J. Young. I thought my card catalog had come to life. And I saw Cornelius Van Til for the first time in my life, and he gave this lecture, and I had no idea what he was talking about. It's come way over my head. But I knew he was smart, you know. I could figure that out. And he gave his lecture, and when he was finished, he sat down in the front row with his back to the audience, and the host of this seminar said, "Do anybody have any questions for Dr. Van Til?" And somebody asked a question. I didn't understand the question. Real complicated question. And Van Til didn't even turn around and look at the guy while the question was being asked. He just sat there quietly, heard the question, and just kept sitting there. He didn't move. And you could feel the tension in the room. I'm saying, "Do something, Dr. Van Til. You know, get up out of that chair. Do something." Finally, he calmly rose and turned around and smiled and brrr, like a machine gun, mowed this guy down. It was unbelievable. I said, "I'm in a place with which I am not familiar." And I was so glad when we had a break for lunch. And we sat down for lunch, and I'll remember that the first course was noodle soup. And I was sitting next to my professor, and across from me was Robert Knudsen, who taught philosophy there at Westminster. And Dr. Knudsen looked across to me and asked me my name, and I told him my name. And he said, just as I took my first sip of soup, he said, "Young man, do you think God is transcendent or immanent?" I had two problems with his question. I didn't know what transcendent meant. And I didn't know what imminent meant. Other than that, I was tracking with him all along. Well, Dr. Knudsen, God bless him, was gracious. He sensed my discomfort and embarrassment and took the trouble to explain to me the difference. And he went on to say that a Christianity that has a God who is never immanent in any way is deism. A God who is so remote that he is removed from the lives of his people. But the God of Christianity is immanent in his being that permeates all things. That he is present in the person of the Holy Spirit with us every moment. He is immanent in history. Through his works of redemption, supremely in the incarnation in his own Son. He said, but a God who is not transcendent is pantheism, where all is God and God is all, and if everything is God, then the final analysis, nothing is God. Because that obscures the difference between nature and supernature, really the difference between the holy and the profane. Needless to say, from that day forward, any time I saw or heard the word transcendence, I listened. Because what Dr. Knudsen did for me that day was to remind me that the God that we worship is high and holy and lifted up. And that when we come into his presence on the Sabbath day, we are not chained to the order of natural things. I brought with me today, actually I brought it the other day and kept it for today, a bulletin from St. Andrew's Chapel, a little church that we have. And our front page of our bulletin looks the same every week. The picture of the Celtic cross, and in the circle there are the solas of the Reformation that define the theology of our church. But at the bottom of the page, there's something written that's there every Sunday, and I want to read it to you today, where it says, "We cross the threshold of the secular to the sacred. From the common to the uncommon. From the profane to the holy." And that's what the author of Hebrews is talking about in chapter 12 when he talks about New Testament worship as a supernatural event, as a taste of heaven. That when people enter into the courts of God, into the courts of praise, into the place of thanksgiving, they cross a line. Now we know that God is not localized in our sanctuaries. He can't be found only in Jerusalem or Mount Gerizim. He can't be confined to one place. But that was as true in the Old Testament as it is today. And yet, nevertheless, even though God's presence was throughout the Midianite wilderness, there was one piece of real estate that was holy ground. Because it was there that God met with Moses and gave him his word. And at that place now for and forever, we find sacred space and sacred time. And every time in the Bible there's an intersection of the divine and the transcendent with this world. The patriarchs mark the spot. Jacob has his vision of the angels ascending and descending on the ladder. And when he wakes up, he's terrified, and he said, "Surely God was in this place, and I knew it not. How awesome is this place?" And he takes oil and anoints the rock that moments before was a simple, common, profane, secular pillow. Now marks Bethel, the entranceway to the house of God. And that's my dream for every Christian who walks in a church on Sunday morning, that he crosses that line. He passes over a threshold. God's outside. God's in the parking lot. We know that. But he has a sacred time that he has appointed to meet with his people. Don't play with it. And in this holy place, we're no longer in the presence of the common, but we're now in the presence of the uncommon. We've moved out of profanity into the holy, where the transcendent majesty of God dwells and comes in the fullness of his supernatural power and being to be with us there. That it's supernatural is seen in this portion of the text where the author of Hebrews is contrasting the experience of New Testament worship with what went on in Sinai when the people had to sanctify themselves for so many days and they weren't allowed to come near and touch the mountain. If they touched the sacred mountain, they would be executed. Only Moses was permitted to ascend on high when they saw God coming down from heaven in the clouds, in the storm, with the lightning and the thunder and the sound of trumpets. The author of Hebrews says, that's not where we are now. You haven't come to the mountain that may be touched and burned with fire, to blackness and darkness and tempest. and the sound of a trumpet and the voice of words, so that those who heard it begged that the word should not be spoken to them anymore. I said to John yesterday morning after he preached on Revelation 1, I said, I can't think of any time in my life where I was so eager for a sermon to end. I said to John MacArthur, as I was feeling during your message, I just wanted you to stop. I couldn't stand it. I couldn't take any more. I said I was going to start flying right up here through the ceiling. It was too much. It was too glorious. I was sitting there in the front row, and I started looking at that thing there that you're all looking at instead of looking at me. And happy to see that the back of my head is so much, looks so much better than my son's. There's one apple that fell way away from the tree. And as he's describing the vision that John had on Patmos, I closed my eyes and I could see what John was seeing in the images of my brain. The exalted Jesus. I couldn't stand it. And what the author says is, we're not at that mountain anymore. But when we come together for worship now, by the power of the Holy Ghost, we are raised, we are transported into the heavenly sanctuary itself. It's the taste of heaven. And who's there? I mentioned this a couple conferences ago here that I preached another church here in Orlando that had a early service and a late service, and they have lots of people at the late service, but they got about 30 people in the early service, and I came to preach at the early service, and there's a sanctuary to seat 2,000 people, and there are 30 people sitting in there. And I got up to the pulpit and I said, appreciate the invitation to preach to you this morning, I said, but when I realize how large a crowd is assembled here for this worship, I'm intimidated. And they all started laughing. I said, I'm not kidding. I said, there's far more here than meets the eye. You want to count the attendance this morning? Are we counting the angels, the archangels? What the author of Hebrews says, the innumerable angels in the heavenly host that are in the heavenly sanctuary, the myriads of myriads, the 10,000, 10 times 10,000 that are crying out day and night, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Because that's where we are every time we come together. And not only are we entering into the heavenly sanctuary where the angels, the archangels, the seraphim, and the cherubim are praising God, singing the antiphonal response, holy, holy, holy. But who else is there? The spirits of just men made perfect. The saints that have gone before us. Oh, how I used to love to worship in 10th Presbyterian Church and sing hymns. I'll never get over this. Standing next to Jim Boyce. Because nobody loved to sing the hymns more than Jim did. And he'd go up on his toes and his hand would be in his back pocket. You know, and he'd, oh, mighty force. He loved it. And I would stand next to him and I could hardly contain myself. It was so joyous. And oh, how I miss him. Except I get to worship with them every Sunday morning. When I enter into the heavenly sanctuary, my father's there, my mother's there, Jim's there. All the saints who have gone before us are part of this multitude. And guess who else is there? God is there. And the Lamb is there. He He's really there. And we talked in the Q&A about the sacraments. I think it was Sinclair who said, the drama that God has blessed his church with is being discounted and thrown out of the church, and modern drama is replacing it. You talk about exchanging the truth for a lie. For the supernatural, why trade the supernatural for the natural where you can get it anywhere? But when we come to the table of the Lord, it's a supernatural event. When we come to the baptismal font and communicate the sign of the covenant of God, the sign of the new covenant, we communicate the mark that is the invisible mark on the soul of everyone who receives it, it's a supernatural event. For you have come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to an innumerable company of angels, to the General Assembly. I've been to General Assemblies of the Presbyterian Church, and I never thought they were a taste of heaven. I enjoyed them, don't get me wrong. But there are General Assemblies, and there are General Assemblies. This is a General Assembly I never want to miss. The Church of the Firstborn who are registered in heaven, to God the Judge of all, to the spirits of just men made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaks better things than that of Abel. Is it any wonder, dear friends, that one of the commandments that Christ gives to his church through the apostolic teaching is that we ought never neglect the assembling together of the saints of God? He has sanctified a day. He has sanctified a people. He has sanctified a place. He has sanctified a word. All of which are instruments of his own Holy Spirit, who works to sanctify us. We cannot focus on the holiness of God without being led to a hunger and thirst in our souls to worship Him. Let's pray. Father, there is nothing more foreign to our fallen nature than a desire to worship you. Because while we were dead and unregenerate, though we knew you, we would not glorify you or honor you as God. Neither were we grateful. But now, O God, since you have raised us from the dead, we are grateful, and our hearts burn to honor you as God. Let thy Spirit so dwell in us and so work on us that we will hunger and thirst for a taste of heaven. In Jesus' name, amen.